Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed are they whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Almighty and merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed what we have devised and desired in our hearts. We have offended you and sinned against your holy law. We have done those things that we should not have done. And we have not done those things that we should have done. Have mercy on us, Lord. Spare us, forgive us, and restore us according to your promises in Christ Jesus. God, our merciful Father, has forgiven all our sins. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his death on the cross and freed us from death by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God, now and forever.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
With you. And
also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your people together into one holy church, the body of Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow the example of your blessed saints in lives of faith and willing service, and with them at last inherit the inexpressible joys that you have prepared for those who love you. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our first lesson is also the sermon text. Revelation chapter 21, the first six verses, the Apostle John is describing a vision of heaven. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, because the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea no longer existed. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And from the throne I heard a loud voice that said, "Look, God's dwelling is with people. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them, and he will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain, because the former things have passed away." The one who was seated on the throne said to me, "Look, I am making everything new." He also said, "Write, for these words are trustworthy and true." And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To anyone who is thirsty, I will give freely from the spring of the water of life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
At this time, the men's group will sing, "There is a Higher Throne."
Thank you.
Our second lesson is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, the great Hall of Faith chapter. And what more should I say? There would not be enough time for me to continue to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets. By faith they conquered kingdoms, carried out justice, obtained things that were promised, shut the mouths of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edges of the sword, were made powerful after being weak, became mighty in battle, and caused foreign armies to flee. Women received back their dead by resurrection, and others who were tortured did not accept their release so that they may take part in a better resurrection. Still others experienced mocking and lashes in addition to chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawed in two. They were tempted. They were killed with a sword. They went around in sheepskins and goatskins, needy, afflicted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them as they wandered in deserts and mountains and caves and holes in the ground. All of these were commended in Scripture by faith. Yet they did not receive what was promised because God had planned something better for us, namely that they would not reach the goal apart from us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we sing the gospel acclamation. The gospel is recorded in Luke 6, beginning at verse 20. Jesus lifted up his eyes to his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, because yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, because you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, because you will laugh. Blessed are you whenever people hate you, and whenever they exclude and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy because of this. Your reward is great in heaven. The fact is, their fathers constantly did the same things to the prophets." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. We'll continue with the children's message. Young children are invited to the front. Have a seat on the step. All right, thanks for coming up, guys. So we're talking about going on a trip today. Do you guys know where we're headed on our trip in our service? Have you picked up on that at all? Yes, sir.
Florida.
Florida. Okay. Would you like to go to Florida? Yes, of course. Arizona? California? Where are we going, Daniel? Alaska. Well, okay, we're done. We're talking about going to heaven. So whenever we go on a trip, we always have a suitcase, right? So we've got a suitcase. We're going to put, I don't know, your favorite, your clothes, you need underwear, you need maybe your baseball bat, some toys, right? Do you need all that for heaven? No? I wonder, can I put this backpack on somebody? Okay, let's do this. All right, so here are some things, excellent, right there. Here are some things we might need. Where are we going? You guys know where heaven is? So I've got my phone. You think it's up there? Huh, I've got my phone. If I look up heaven on a GPS, will I find it? No, if I look for hell, it's in the UP. I think there's another hell. There is a literal hell. I think you know that. Here's a book of maps. You think this would be helpful, guys? Wisconsin muskie fishing maps. There's heaven to be found in here, don't you think? No? Okay. How about tissue? On a trip, don't you need tissue? Like if you get sick, you start blowing your nose, you gotta stay hydrated, you need bottled water, right? And I got one more thing in here. It has disappeared. It is at the very bottom. Oh, a flashlight. Do you ever take a flashlight on a trip? No? Will we need a flashlight in heaven? No, why not? Actually, there's no sun in heaven. Because the Son of God, Jesus, is the light. And we don't need tissues, because in the reading we had, we'll talk about it in the sermon, says God will wipe all of our tears from our eyes. We don't need tissue. We don't need water, because we will be fed with streams of the water of life. And so how do we get there? All of those things. We need nothing. Jesus takes us. He's the way. What a blessing to know that we're headed for heaven. And all we have to do to prepare is just continue to believe, which is something God has done for us in the first place. Let's fold our hands, bow our heads, we'll pray. Dear Jesus, we are all on a trip to the same place. Maybe we'll get to Florida, Alaska, different places like that. Maybe we'll just go out to the woods today. But we are all headed for heaven. Thank you for your grace and for your forgiveness. Thank you for providing everything we need in your name. Amen. Thanks for coming up. We'll sing the next hymn.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The scripture for our meditation is that first reading from Romans, Revelation, chapter 21. Revelation 21. In Jesus' name, dear friends, I can't. I can't do it. I can't fix things. I can't make things better. When things are going wrong, I can't fix my family. I can't protect those I love from the things that might hurt them all the time. I can't stand the pain when it comes into my life or when it comes into the lives of those I love. I can't stop, and now here you can fill in the blank with things that might apply to you. I can't stop binge drinking, binge eating, binge watching, binge spending. I can't stop working too much or not working enough. I can't stop being jealous of others or being critical of others. I can't get enough attention. I can't get enough likes, hearts, affirmation, recognition. I can't get no satisfaction. I cannot understand what I do, for I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot do it. I do not do the good I want to do. Instead, I do the evil I do not want to do. I can't. I just can't do it. But God can. And He will. In this world, in your life, and in mine, there's a lot of I can't. I just can't do it. I can't fix this. So this morning, let's set our hearts on things above. Let's look ahead to where we're headed, to our home in heaven. Through the pen of the Apostle John and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, let's enjoy a glimpse of heaven where can'ts are no more. And everything is good and right and new. John is old when he writes these words. He's in his 90s. I know some of you are in your 90s. We have a 104-year-old sister with us today. But he's in his 90s. His body is weary. Life's journey has taken its toll. His friends are gone. Peter has died. Paul, too, was martyred. Both men gone now at least 30 years. None of the other original 12 disciples are alive, only John. And John is in exile. He's living on the Roman version of Alcatraz. It's a small, rocky island of Patmos off the coast of Asia Minor. From there, he can see his beloved city of Ephesus. He remembers the Christians there. He served as their pastor. He thinks about the wider church. So many churches spread, planted by the Apostle Paul during his missionary journeys. But now they're under tremendous pressure. Worldliness, apathy, persecution, some churches collapsing from within. The Christian church, his beloved church, his Savior Jesus church, the Savior with whom he once walked and talked. The church is taking it on a chin. And all John can do is watch it fall apart from a distance. As he hears this voice from the throne in chapter 21, he's heard it many times throughout Revelation, but he hears it again. I wonder, does he remember when he heard it on the mountain, the Mount of Transfiguration. There, the voice of the Father, awesome, fear-inducing, "This is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." And there too is Jesus speaking, you'll remember, incredibly with Moses and Elijah about his upcoming final trip to the cross. And then he tells John, James, Peter to get up and not be afraid. That was 60 years ago. It's the same John and the same Jesus. No doubt he remembers that voice on the Mount of Transfiguration. A couple of months after that, the Lord spoke again on another mount, Mount Calvary. He spoke words of forgiveness and anguish, and then of finality and commitment. "It is finished. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And now, 6 decades later, at Jesus' invitation, John looks into the future. He looks into eternity to see what's at the end of this life's journey, the destination toward which all of God's people are headed. He shows him a glimpse of heaven. This is your glimpse, that John's Lord is our Lord, and this heaven is our home too. So let's take it all in. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, because the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea no longer existed." No more sea. Nothing to separate God's people from one another, nothing to separate God's people from God. The old has gone, the new has come. "And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband." Is there anything more beautiful than a bride? One of the side benefits I get as a pastor is I get an early glimpse, often, of a new bride before the service. And then as she's ready to make her way into the venue at the beginning of the aisle, and I have to tell you, I have never seen an ugly bride. I've seen a groom or two that could have used an alteration, but never a bride. And so when the Lord Jesus says that our heavenly home is like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband on their wedding day, doesn't that make you want to go home? Because the world to which you and I wake up to every morning could not possibly be described as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. Not this world. Not at any time. A teenager takes his own life. Another one endures social media bullying that will scar her for life. Leaders and politicians let us down every day. Every week there's word of another Christian leader somewhere, maybe famous, maybe not, who has brought shame and disgrace upon the name of Jesus. Ordinary Christian people like you and me are becoming more and more indistinguishable from the rest of the world around us. There's a lot of blame to go around, and we've got all these fingers we can point, but we carry plenty of blame and guilt and sin. Not a day goes by, not even an hour, that we don't do the same. Let others down with selfishness, pettiness, and sin. Not a day goes by, not even an hour, that we don't bring shame and disgrace upon the name of Jesus. We blend in with a hell-bent, in cahoots with Satan world all around us. Left to ourselves, our destination is not pleasant. Now, hell is not a place that garners, say, only a one-star rating on a scale of 1 to 5. It is untold, unfathomable misery for all time. It never ends. Satan doesn't want to be there. That tells you how awful and eternal it is. But God's people are headed for a different destination. Thanks to God's love and grace, from the throne I heard a loud voice that said, "Look, God's dwelling is with people. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them, and he will be their God." He did it once already. God did. Came here in the person of his Son, Jesus Christ. Came here to be with us, to be one of us, to be here for us, to live and suffer and die. All of that perfectly and innocently, to rise again. He did it one time for all time to pay the price for all sin, yours and mine included. And by the Holy Spirit, gave us the faith to believe this to be true and to know that this applies to me and to you. And get this, he says he's coming back. Whether he comes for you and me at the end of all things, or when he decides individually for each one of us our time here is done, he will take us to be with him for all eternity. Oh, we look forward to that. That is a forward-looking thing. That's coming. They will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will be their God. But that isn't just about the future. This is the present. Jesus says you have that relationship with him, with God, right now. Jesus says that he is the groom, you and I, we are the bride, you and I. When you looked in the mirror this morning, did you see a beautiful bride? Jesus did. He says that you have been his bride ever since your baptism, when he washed away your sin with his forgiveness, the water, and the word, the Holy Spirit working. You are, in his eyes, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish. You are holy and blameless. You and I look at ourselves and we see how imperfect and flawed and damaged and weak we are. But God looks at us, and by virtue of that gift of faith placed inside of us by the Spirit, he sees us covered in Jesus' righteousness and holiness and forgiveness. And like a beautiful bride, we are perfect in his sight. We don't see it now, but we will at the end of our journey in heaven. There's more. Actually, no more. Listen to these words. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain, because the former things have passed away. No more. No more tears of sorrow. The same hands that stretched out the heavens will touch your cheeks. The same hands that formed the mountains will caress your face. The same hands that curled in agony as the Roman spikes set through them, they will one day cup your face and wipe away, brush away all those tears forever. I love these words. No more. No more tears. No more death. No more mourning. No more crying. No more pain. No more I can't. No more failure. No more waiting. No more. Not ever again. No more. There is one more description of our destination, one more declaration from Jesus. He's the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last letters of the Greek alphabet, the beginning and the end. He says, "I am making everything new." It's hard to see things get old. I think back to the places I grew up, places I've been, places I've visited. You do it too. And when you go back, you see that everything gets old. Everything wears out. It gets torn down and discarded, replaced maybe, certainly forgotten. It's even worse when people get old. When you and I become or approach what others declare to be old. I'll always remember one trip up here and then central Wisconsin about 15 years ago. It was during our time in Arizona. And we came up here to visit, go fishing. But we stopped at a country church with a cemetery just outside of Marshfield, Wisconsin. It's where one set of my grandparents are buried. And my kids at that time, all 15 years younger, they were amazed. They were fascinated at how many tombstones had the name Luchterhand on them. And all these other names that I said were relatives, ancestors of mine, and many of them I never knew. But one of my daughters, about 6 years old at the time, looked at me with such wide-eyed innocence and compassion, and she said, "Daddy, I am so sorry that so many of your relatives died. And they will continue to die. Until Jesus says, no more. And he brings all of this to an end. And so will we die. But we have so much to look forward to at the end of this journey. Thanks to Jesus, who said to John and to us, these words are trustworthy and true. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To anyone who is thirsty, I will give freely from the spring of the water of life." I'm not the only one who wishes I could fix everything that's wrong here. I can't. I can't do it. You can't. But God can. And he will. He does even now. He restores my soul. He doesn't repair or reform. He restores. He doesn't camouflage over the old. He restores everything to new. And I cannot wait until the day when Jesus says, "No more. Come home. I am making everything new." Amen. Please stand. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We confess the Christian faith using the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Of all that is seen and unseen, we believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. We'll continue with the prayer of the church as printed at the bottom of page 11 and on the screen. With grateful hearts, Lord, that great cloud of witnesses whose living trust in you, recorded in your word, becomes an example for us to imitate and follow.
Inspire us as we remember them and grant us your blessing.
With grateful hearts, Lord,
we remember before you this day
the reformers and confessors who faced the terror of church and empire, but stood firm in your truth, because they were moved by grace, empowered by faith, and guided by Scripture.
Inspire us as we remember them, and grant us their courage.
With grateful hearts, Lord,
we remember before you this day
your faithful followers of every age, among them our parents and grandparents, and our mentors and models, whom your Spirit called, gathered, enlightened, and sanctified to be your holy church, and by whose faithful words and deeds the gospel of your grace arrived also to us.
Inspire us as we remember them, and grant us their resolve.
With grateful hearts, Lord,
we remember before you this day
those we have known who endured uncommon handicaps, chronic illnesses, and severe hardships, yet followed you in simple faith, and live their lives with patience and persistence.
Inspire us as we remember them, and grant us their joy.
With grateful hearts, Lord,
we remember before you this day
our own loved ones whose memories still burn within our hearts, whom you have called in your good time from their labors in life to that life which knows no end. Hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. Empower us, Lord, to carry on the work you gave to your people of the past, trusting your Son, holding to your word, confessing your truth, loving the lost, reaching out with your love, until you call us too, by your great grace in Jesus Christ, to join them where memories are swallowed up in everlasting joy.
Amen.
During the musical selection, please take a moment, sign our friendship register. You'll find those on either side of the aisle. Take one, pass it on, sign it for yourself, pass it on. Thank you. Please stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who in blessing his saints of the past has given us assurance and hope that following their example, we may run the race marked out for us and receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Blessed are you, O Lord, of heaven and earth. We praise and thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, and we remember the great acts of love through which he has ransomed us from sin, death, and the devil's power. By his incarnation, he became one with us. By his perfect life, he fulfilled your holy will. By his innocent death, he overcame hell. By his rising from the grave, he opened heaven. Invited by your grace and instructed by your word, we approach your table with repentant and joyful hearts. Strengthen us through Christ's body and blood, and preserve in us the true faith until we feast with him and all his ransomed people in glory everlasting.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to them, and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
You may be seated. At this time, we invite communicant members of our congregation or of Sister Wells or ELS churches to join us in receiving the Lord's Supper at the direction of the ushers. The hymns that will be sung are found in the worship folder. Come, for all is ready. Please stand. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this saving gift. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Receive with believing hearts the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. At this time, the men's group will sing a closing hymn. Once again, a good morning and welcome. I feel out of breath, honestly. Listening to the singing, the table that was here when you began singing for all the saints, I think they would tell you, if they could even hear me, that I actually forgot the words that I'm supposed to say. Just so moving to hear that singing and how the service all tied together. I'm just sharing with you my breathless thoughts. It doesn't mean that you are. We're so grateful to have you here. We have fellowship time, coffee and treats. We need people to sign up for the weeks to come. And honestly, if you think you're going to bring something, do sign your name on that piece of paper. It doesn't mean that you are, condemned to having to do it if something happens, but that lets the folks know who usually bring that they may not have to prepare so much. So keep that in mind. Sign up for treats on Sunday mornings. There is a sheet on the treat table. Sunday school Bible class start about 20 minutes from now. There is a snow shovel sign up that is lots of spaces, lots of opportunities to serve there, beginning at the end of November through whenever. I think it's April or May, March. Did I say May? March, April. And then Meditations, the new edition is here. It begins November 27th, so you can pick that up. They're $3 a piece, both regular size and large print. God bless you on this day.